Good morning. I'm glad you could join us. So excited that you're here today. Just a reminder, everybody, this week and next week, we'll be doing our drive-in church in our parking lot here on the campus at 10:30 on Sunday mornings. Well, it's exciting to see you here. We will continue to do our online services. They'll be available on Facebook, also on YouTube, and at our website at ssag.org. So we're excited to be here this morning and share with you. Before I begin today's message, I want to address a terrible incident that took place here in Georgia a few weeks ago. A young man named, young African-American man named Ahmed Aubrey was killed. And if you've seen the video, you can agree with Phil Wallace, one of the leaders at our district office, that racism is a deadly disease. It's as deadly as COVID-19 and has maybe more profound impact on our time and culture. That we should be using at least the same effort and energy to combat this deadly disease of racism as we're using to combat the virus. So how do we respond as a church? Well, we're called to be peacemakers with them, using the message of the cross as a bridge between hate and love. The reality is, sin kills. We have a message of life and hope in Jesus. That's for all people who God sees as valued and worth the sacrifice that his son made to redeem them. Our prayer should be with this young man's family and with the community that he lives in. And let's pray that God will help us see racism come to an end. Today, I'd like to begin a message called Don't Miss the Party. My parents told me a story about their wedding day. My dad's brother and my mom's brother almost missed the wedding. They were very, very late because they had gotten distracted and busy in checking out a car. And what we don't want to do is do what they did, which is they almost missed the party. So today, as we look at this message in this series called In Between, we need to understand that as we're beginning to move to some normal activities, we're still caught in an in-between time. It's been difficult dealing with COVID-19 and all that has meant for us, but I believe God has new opportunities and experiences for us that we should be anticipating and preparing for. There may be new ways to share about Jesus with others, new awarenesses of God's power and grace, new connections in the Holy Spirit with both our community and the church. For the disciples of Jesus, there was a new power that would come into their lives on the day of Pentecost, a new outpouring of the Holy Spirit. They would receive a power to live and share the message of hope that comes with a relationship with their Savior Jesus. But they had been in an in-between time as well. You see, Jesus had taught them. He had lived with them. He suffered and died and then rose from the dead for them. And then he had spent time with them. And then he returned to heaven and told them to wait. In Acts 1:15, it tells us that there were 120 people waiting on the day of Pentecost when the power of the Holy Spirit was poured out. But in 1 Corinthians 15:6, it tells us that 500 people were there the day Jesus told them to return to Jerusalem and to wait for what was coming. 120 would experience the power of the Holy Spirit and the beginning of what we call the church today, and literally would be elements that would change the world as we know it. But what about the other 380? Why weren't they there? Well, I really can't say for certain, but our experiences in this in-between time has led me to identify maybe three obstacles that could have impacted their lives, and I know are impacting ours. Three enemies that can keep us from the amazing thing God is preparing for us. As we look at the life of Elijah, a powerful prophet who lived in ancient Israel some 2,900 years ago, we can see these enemies try to steal God's purpose and plan from his life and from the legacy he would live. So let's look at these enemies and see how we can avoid them. First off, there's the enemy of discouragement. Elijah had been a part of some very powerful experiences. He had been a voice to the people of Israel speaking for God. And God had used him in a mighty way to impact the lives of his community. He had been used by God to raise a boy from the dead and restore him back to his family. He had prayed that it wouldn't rain, and it didn't rain for 3 years. In a confrontation with false prophets, he had called down fire from heaven to consume a sacrifice and to bring the reality of God to the people. He had even outrun a horse. But in 1 Kings 19, verses 3 through 5, we see him confront this enemy, the enemy of discouragement. In verse 3, it says, Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. And when he came to Beersheba in Judea, he left his servant there, and while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. He came to a bush and sat down under it and prayed that he might die. I have had enough, Lord, he said. Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. All at once an angel touched him and said, get up and eat. You see, Elijah was afraid. After all these amazing events that God had performed through his life, he heard that the queen, who was his enemy, had said she was going to kill him. The threat unlocked the power of discouragement and even despair in Elijah's life. We who have been followers of Jesus can fall into the same trap. We can especially have that be true in our lives in the events that have taken place recently. We may have seen God do some amazing things. We may have seen God change people's lives or have experienced miracles or seen them happen in others' lives. But this new threat sends us or can send us into a tailspin. It's a real enemy. I recently, this week, actually read about a pastor who had seen many amazing things happen in his ministry, had killed himself. He had fallen prey to this enemy called discouragement. I can't judge him, because I myself have even had to battle this enemy in my life. We have to learn the warning signs and then lean into God's provision. We must be careful of exhaustion, not just physical exhaustion, but mental and emotional exhaustion. Elijah had been extremely busy, and he hadn't taken time to rest. You have to be careful who you listen to. You see, there are lots of voices that want to speak into our life, and not all of them are voices that will encourage or call us to what God has in store for us. We have to reconnect to truth through worship and through the scripture and through godly conversation. And we have to be willing to ask for help. In my own life, this has been a critical thing for me. I have struggled myself, and I cannot tell you how valuable the voice of those who have spoken positively into my life, the most important of which has been my wife, Denise. She has been an encouragement to me. But there's another enemy that will come and want to steal from us, want to keep us, that want to make us like the 380 and not be at the party, not be at that moment when God wants to do some significant thing in our life. It's the enemy of doubt. See, in Elijah's life, he had forgotten who God is, and thus he had forgotten what God can do. In 1 Kings 19, 9 through 18, it is the continuation of the story. God had spoken to Elijah and told him to go to Mount Horeb. He had told him to go there because he had gotten caught in this trap of doubt and discouragement. In verses 9 through 11, it says, then he went into a cave and spent the night there. And the word of the Lord came to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? And he replied, I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, put your prophets to death by the sword. And I'm the only one left. Now they're trying to kill me too. Verse 11 says, then the Lord said, go out, stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Elijah had focused in on who he was and what was going on in his life. He had failed to see or be reminded of who God is. You see, God had been God through the whole process, and he was still God even when the queen had made the threat against his life. He began to see everything through the filter of his experience and what he was going through, not through the filter of who God is. And that's where doubt can begin to creep into our life. Elijah had forgotten, and he began to doubt that God could take care of him. If fear is driving our life, and then our belief that God is still in control will be lost. But here's the truth. God's still God. He's still God. When Elijah was there, he was still God in that time that the disciples were waiting and didn't know what was going to happen next. He's still God right now in the middle of this pandemic that's affecting our world. And the disciples had reason to doubt and fear in their lives. The Romans of that time, who were the leaders of that time, and the religious leaders had wanted to persecute them and silence them. Yet they chose to believe that God had a purpose in their life. 1 Kings 19 in verse 15, it says this: the Lord spoke to Moses, not through the earthquake or through the fire, but through a still small voice. And here's what he said to him. He said in verse 15, go back the way you came. Go back. Elijah went back and continued to see God do amazing things, even in the face of severe opposition. He went back because he believed God had a plan. And in his going back, he found a protege, and God showed him who was going to take his place. He anointed new leaders for the land, and he saw God do amazing things. Those disciples and those followers, those 120, they choose to believe that God was still in control and still had a plan and that he would keep his promise. And so on the day of Pentecost, they would experience the power of the Holy Spirit. They would be empowered to do amazing things. The 380 allowed discouragement and doubt to keep them from the party. The third enemy that I'd like to share with you today is the enemy of distraction. Elijah, as he continued his ministry, came to a time when he knew that his life on earth was coming to a close. God had given him a replacement in a man named Elisha, and the time for transition had come. In 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 15, we read the story. You see, the two men began a journey, and they traveled to three towns where they had had centers of ministry, and they had done amazing things. At each place, Elijah tells Elisha to stay here. But each time, Elisha responds, as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you. In other words, he would not be distracted from the task at hand. Others would speak to Elisha and try to distract him or dissuade him, and he wouldn't have any part of it. He became singular in his focus. When the two of them arrived at their destination and they crossed over the River Jordan after God miraculously stopped the waters, and they came to the other side, an amazing thing happened. It was here that Elijah asked Elisha some significant things. So let me read. In verse 9, it says, when they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, tell me what I can do for you before I'm taken from you. Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit, Elisha replied. You have asked a difficult thing, Elijah said. Yet if you see me when I am taken from me, it will be yours. Otherwise, it will not. And as they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them. And Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. And Elisha saw this and cried out, my father, the chariots and horsemen of Israel. And Elisha saw him no more, and took hold of his garment and tore it in two. And Elisha picked up Elisha's cloak that had fallen from him and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. He took the cloak that had fallen from Elijah, struck the water with it, and he said, "Where is the Lord, the God of Elisha?" And when he struck the water, it divided to the right and the left, and he crossed over. You see, Elisha could have easily been distracted in this whole process. There are lots of things that can come into our life that will distract us. But because he refused to be distracted, he experienced that power that had been on his mentor, that power of the prophet came upon him. The 120 that had gathered on the day of Pentecost wouldn't be distracted either. And they would experience the power of the Holy Spirit that would empower them and change their lives, literally make them world changers in their own time. Lots of things will attempt to distract us as we come out of this in-between time. There will be well-meaning people who will try to pull us away. There'll be the pressures of work and life. There'll be entertainment and media, all of which will try to create distraction in our life. But I believe it's a time of focus. The 380 missed an opportunity, a unique opportunity to be at the party. I don't want to let discouragement or doubt or distraction keep me from what God has planned for me. I believe this, that God has something incredible in store for each and every one of us as individuals and as a church. If we'll just stay focused, if we'll just stay engaged, if we'll just stay aware of what God is doing, I promise you, God is faithful. I don't want to miss the party. I hope you don't either. Here's the thing. If you're going to be at the party, you got to be invited. And to be invited, you have to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And if you're not a follower, you can become one today, simply asking him to come into your life, to take away your failure, your mistakes, your sins, and to become the Lord of your life. Having done that, there's an invitation to the power that God wants to bring into our lives, to the reality of his presence and to the reality of his purpose for our life. I believe it's available to all of us. We may have been caught in a time that's in between, but I believe that God is doing amazing things, and I want to be a part of it. I hope you do too. To all my Southside family, hey, let's be at the party. Let's not miss the party. God's doing something amazing. Let's be a part of it. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you this morning that you're still the God who can do the miraculous. You're the God who worked in Elijah and Elisha's life. You're the God who did miracles and literally spoke to a generation and a nation. You're the God that was there when the 120 experienced the power of the Holy Spirit and became empowered to share the reality of who Jesus is and what he can do in our life and changed a world. You're a God who's been working in the church since that time. And Lord, I believe you're the God who wants to work in our lives as we make this transition out of this in-between time into what you have in store for us. So, Lord, I ask that we would be not distracted, not caught up with the tyranny of doubt, not caught up in that powerful tangle of discouragement, but, Lord, that we would be anticipating what you are going to do and are already doing in our lives and through our lives. Lord, I pray for each person here that maybe has been caught into those webs. Lord, I thank you that just like you set Elijah free, just like you equipped Elisha, just like you equipped the 120, you can equip us so that we don't miss the party. Lord, we call upon you and we look to you. We remember who you are and we thank you that you have a plan. I ask these things in Jesus' name and I believe you have done them. Amen. Well, I hope you have an amazing day and an amazing week. I'm excited. I hope to see you at our drive-in church, and we look forward to the day when we can meet together. God bless you. We'll see you soon.